So I'll give you just a little background about myself before I get started with what I wrote. So I am an actor and a writer, and I went to NYU for School of the Arts, where I majored in acting, and I've been freelancing as an actor and writer in New York City, which is a whole other kind of hustle. I was curious, how many people here have PKU? Awesome, wow, okay, great. And how many people here are parents of somebody or a caretaker of somebody who has PKU? Wow, okay, very cool. Very awesome. Is there anybody who's both? Just curious. Okay, no, okay, cool. All right, so I'm really excited to be here because I believe that building a PKU community is so, so essential. I'm blessed, like I mentioned, to have a sister who also has PKU. And growing up, we really created an organic support system for each other without even realizing that that's what was happening. But we drank our formula at the same time, and we even fought over who got the cup that had a little bit more. Which sounds weird, right?
Yeah.
I know a lot of the time it's kind of, there's like challenges to drinking shake, but my mom actually had to devise the system where whoever poured it, the other person got to pick the cup. Which then, for some reason, I always wound up pouring it. You know, a lot of the time it can feel like a struggle to drink our PKU shakes. And I honestly did not always love drinking it. I remember as a kid, I got really irritated by certain aspects of my shake. I enjoyed the feeling I got after I drank it. My sister and I would call it like this really, like you get this really happy place, right? Because you've got all of a sudden all these nutrients that you need the whole time, and I would feel like kind of relaxed. I don't know if anybody else ever feels that way. But I didn't like the way it smelled. And I didn't like the way it tasted when it had been like sitting around all day, you know? So my mom came up with these fun and creative ways to get around what we didn't like. She'd buy these like really windy, colorful straws. And then that was fun because we got to watch the shake make its way up to us, which was more fun, but it also practically a tall straw increased the distance between our nose and the smell of the shake, which was also helpful. She'd also make our shakes only when we were about to drink it, so it would taste more fresh. And she had this little star sticker system so that we could see whenever we drank all our shakes, we got a little star. And so that made it more interesting, more fun. My mother, as fate would have it, has a PhD in genetics, which she had before we were born. Yeah, so that was really interesting. And I have to say that although she had a working knowledge of the science behind it, it did not make it any easier for her. When she found out that we had PKU, she was very disturbed because a lot of the information out there about PKU is very clinical and is about what happens if you don't stay on diet. And so when you first are confronted with your kid being diagnosed with this, it's disturbing, right? Because you don't know, my mother didn't know if we'd grow up to lead normal lives, because at that time, I was 28. So, you know, around 30 years ago, there weren't that many examples of people who were in their 30s and 40s who were thriving with PKU. Now there are, and now we know. And I think you're seeing that now, like if you go on social media and you go online, you can see there's a really robust community of people with PKU who are thriving, right? So hopefully that's a little more comforting. But even with my mom knowing what PKU was, it was really scary for her, you know? And I think that that's a big part of the reason why having a supportive community is so essential, because PKU can feel really isolating. And all the information we get that's clinical, it's necessary, definitely necessary, but it's also scary. So going to regular visits to the hospital to take a blood test, how many people have done that? Yeah. Now we also have the finger prick, which is a little easier because we can mail it in and so it's not as stressful, but that was stressful for both parents and kids. But as important as it is to stay on diet and understand what happens if we go off diet, it's empowering to know that others are on that journey with you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And to connect with them outside of the hospital environment. And so when my sister and I first went to different schools, it hit me, for the first time ever, I'd be in a building where likely no one else had PKU. And it was a strange feeling, but it also helped me realize how wonderful it was to have that determines your ability to handle a really rigorous curriculum. There's a lot of AP classes and all that. And my school that I went to, High School of American Studies, it majors in history. So I wound up taking a couple of history APs and a literature AP. And I actually scored high enough on those to allow them to count as credit towards my college education, which NYU ain't cheap. So I was able to carve off a whole semester and due to those AP credits, which was really helpful for our family. And I wound up graduating with honors from New York University, and I got a special award for my acting studio for outstanding achievement.
Yay.
Thank you. And so I'm learning how to get comfortable with naming my accomplishments. My therapist suggested that I try acknowledging reality. And I'm saying that because it sounds funnier than it is. But actually, it's about like not just focusing in on the moment, right? Like I'm here with you guys in this room. But it's also focusing and appreciating the things we've done already that have gone really well, right? Like the steps that we've taken and all the things that we do each and every day that have a positive impact on ourselves and the people around us. For those of us with PKU, I believe that staying on diet is the biggest accomplishment we can ever make. No matter how many degrees we earn or how many awards we win, developing and sustaining the discipline, the strength, and the fortitude that it takes to stay on diet is hands down the most powerful thing that we can accomplish. That's how much energy it requires. And that's how good it is for us. So I've never been interested in trying illicit drugs. I don't like the effect alcohol has on me, because I always want to be in control of my mind, right? I've grown up knowing that I am uniquely in control of my mind. My decisions on a daily basis influence my memory, my concentration, my mood. People with PKU are closely in tune with a reality that some people never realize, which is that how we choose to take care of ourselves deeply affects the quality of our life, and we are in control of these choices every single day. So when I was on the train over here, I researched quotes about the brain. Like, let me find a cool quote about brain. Viktor Frankl, an Austrian neurologist, says, "Everything can be taken from a human, but one thing, the last of human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way." So as someone with PKU, we have, a given set of circumstances. We must eat a certain way. How we navigate this circumstance, though, is completely up to us. I have a confession to make. Until quite recently, I have played a passive role. I like that ringtone also. I have played a passive role in the dietary management of my PKU. I have always had good levels. My doctors and the dietitians at clinic would often bring me around to other patients and be like, "Hey, look, you can do it. This is a great role model, right?" And I've always felt positively about my special diet. I've always loved my shake. I love that I've eaten mostly fruits and veggies. How many people, like, as you guys get older, you're gonna see, like, everybody's like, "I'm trying just to eat fruits and vegetables, cut out carbs, cut out meat." And I'm like, "Ha! We got this!" Basically, I can't break down amino acid phenylalanine, which is found in foods that are high in protein. So I've never eaten meat, cheese, yogurt, eggs, milk, nuts, dairy, none of that. And then they're like, what? Intimate relationship to discipline. and a working knowledge of metabolism and genetics that most people never have. But outside of those advantages, we are just normal people. And hopefully we're doing our best, and we're loving our hardest, and we're fighting to make the world a better place day by day. And with a strong, supportive community, I think that it's easier to be reminded of that. On that note, there's a couple of projects I'm doing slash involved in that I would love if you guys checked out. I've been doing a series of interviews with people who have PKU on YouTube, and the goal of them is to be positive and to be like just about what do they do in daily life, how do they love PKU, so you can check that out. Search my name, William Isabella PKU, on YouTube. The videos will show up. And then also, I traveled to London last summer to be interviewed for a documentary by this guy, Jack Everett. He's a filmmaker in London who also has PKU. And he's making a documentary about PKU called So What Can You Eat? and it's a really cool documentary because what it is his friend, who does not have PKU, decided to try out the PKU diet for a month and see what effect it had on her. And he documented her doing this. And then I flew out there to talk to him. He's talked to a few other people who have PKU. And it's a really cool documentary. The trailer's out. The page is up on Facebook, So What Can You Eat? And also, the National PKU Alliance, you guys might know about this already, but the National PKU Alliance is going to lobby Congress to get the Medical Nutrition Equity Act passed. They introduced that act to Congress last year in May of 2017. They're going to be going there again this year and lobbying. And anybody can volunteer to go and lobby. I think they have discounted hotel rates. If you reach out to them, they can connect you with that. And it's basically an act that would require insurance plans to make coverage of medical foods for both children and adults diagnosed with inborn errors of metabolism mandatory. And so patients, it's going to be on the upcoming Patients and Providers for Medical Nutrition Equity Act, HILDAE, that was a mouthful, but on June 1st, 2018.